So over the last couple of lectures, Artemy has been telling you about neural networks and how these major advances have been coming about as a result of this new technology. In this lesson, we're more going to talk about the caveats of machine learning and things to think about before you deploy these new systems. So one of the major pieces of advice that we have for you is that data and questions come before algorithms. So that is, a lot of machine learning problems don't need advanced techniques like deep neural networks with LSTMs and ReLUs and all these other buzzwords, right? A lot of questions can be solved by having a really clear question that you're answering and a really good data set that you have to answer that question. And so the first things to think about are, what do I want to know? And if I can't know what I want to know, is there something that will be useful anyway? And secondly, do I have the data to answer that question? That if I don't have that data, how can I go about and get it? And so neural networks oftentimes really need really large data sets in order to work properly. And for smaller data sets, there are other different algorithms that work better with small data. And so this is one thing to think about, is trying these other algorithms before jumping on the neural network hype train. And again, to emphasize, think about data and questions first before we think about algorithms. So on that point about clean data though, another point we want to make is that it's not always obvious how to make data clean. And so in particular, certain things are obvious, right? You can represent age as a number. You can represent zip code as a number. But other things aren't so obvious. So let's imagine we want to build a product recommendation system. And you've seen that someone in the past has bought a tripod, they've bought a microphone. Well, how do we take that data and make new recommendations? Right, one way you could do it is to literally list the product number that they bought. But that might be really confusing. Maybe you want to represent that as they bought a tripod. So maybe if you see they've bought a tripod and they bought a microphone, they may also need a camera. But at the same time, if you see that they've been looking at 6 different kinds of tripod, maybe you do want those as exactly the tripod that they are, such you can make a different recommendation for another tripod, for instance. So another thing is that natural language data can be really difficult to represent. And so you might take each individual word and make it a number, but a lot of times these words combine in difficult ways. Now, hypothetically, you could take an entire sentence and represent it as a number, but that's not going to be very useful to use because most sentences aren't used all that many times. So again, it's really tricky and requires a lot of research to figure out how to say, map something like natural language data and have it say, oh, this person likes me or doesn't like me. So the other caveat we want to mention is this concept of hardware. So these neural networks and other machine learning algorithms oftentimes need to be trained on large data sets, and they need to run through this data a lot of times. And so the thing is that it often takes a lot of hardware in order to practically train these models. And so AlphaGo, which we talked about a couple of lessons ago, that actually ran on something called a tensor processing unit, which is a specially designed piece of hardware in order to run fast. And so you don't necessarily need that much customized, specialized hardware, but it is the case that oftentimes you need lots of graphics cards or access to something like the Amazon cloud in order to practically train these algorithms. So it's another thing to keep in mind of, depending on how long you have to train, there can be different trade-offs in machine learning algorithms. A third thing though to talk about, which I think is big, is this idea of transparency and robustness. So many of you may have seen projectile motion, either in introductory physics class, and let's think about, we have paratroopers that are going to jump out of an airplane, and we're going to take Newton's laws of motion with projectiles that say, well, the velocity with which they hit the ground is the square root of 2 times the height they jumped times the acceleration due to gravity. And if we run those numbers, we find that they're going to hit the ground at 120 miles an hour. That's a really fast speed. So they probably shouldn't be jumping, right? Well, no, right? So we know Newton's laws and with projectiles ignore air resistance, and these paratroopers have parachutes which operate entirely under air resistance. So we know that this calculation is going to be wrong because of air resistance being around. Okay, so here's another example. There's a neural network that classified this panda with 57.7%, and it classified this very close image of a panda as a gibbon with 99.3%. So why is it that the neural network made this mistake? Well, it's really not clear, right? And so this is one of the major benefits of, say, scientific discoveries over pure machine learning. In science, we often know what the assumptions are and when those assumptions don't no longer hold. While with machine learning algorithms, in particular the more advanced machine learning algorithms, we don't really know what core assumptions they're operating under and therefore when we would expect them to fail. So this is something to keep in mind before you deploy or use a machine learning algorithm, is to understand what you need to know in terms of what kinds of mistakes that it's going to make or not. And this particular example was made with a very particular kind of thing called an adversarial input, where they knew how the neural network behaved, and they took that original panda image and found a very small change in the image that's an imperceptible change to humans, but to the neural network made a very big difference. And so there are kind of two messages to come here. One of which is that while it seems like machine learning algorithms are intelligent and often reproducing human intelligence, it's certainly true that they don't make mistakes in the same way humans make. And the second thing to be wary of is this kind of security issue, in that there are these kinds of inputs that can completely fool the system in ways that are really unclear. And so it's important to keep these kinds of things in mind before you just let them loose and let them do whatever they want. Another major caveat we want to talk about are what we're calling feedback effects. That is when the neural network influences its own predictions. And so a simple example of this is that TCAS system that was mentioned way back in lesson one, where it was this sort of series of if statements that told a pilot how to behave in order to try to avoid two pilots colliding. One problem with the original TCAS system is it didn't know about something called the ground, and so it would oftentimes make bad predictions to pilots, say when they were taking off and landing. And so the system wasn't really sophisticated enough to deal with the full environment in which it was deployed. And so part of the problem was that pilots now sort of learned to not really trust the system because it wasn't making the decisions that they hoped it to make. And so because of this feedback loop, the system wasn't as effective as they hoped it would be originally and had to upgrade the system several times. So let's consider another example from epidemiology, where maybe we're going to model a disease outbreak and we're going to try to see how quickly it's going to spread through the population. Now these models often assume that I'm going to do what I normally do. So I'm going to go to work, I'm going to come home, maybe I'll go to a friend's house, and that's going to influence who I interact with and therefore who I can spread the disease to. However, if I'm going to take this epidemiology model and say, oh my gosh, this is really bad, and then announce to everybody that we should be really careful, well now all of a sudden maybe I'm not going to be going to work, maybe I'm going to do something entirely different instead, and maybe in fact I have the disease, but I'm going to go to an entirely different city to avoid it, thus spreading the disease much faster than if I hadn't used the model. So it's important to make sure that the model kind of isn't influencing how the system that it's modeling is going to behave. And another kind of example of this comes from something called recidivism in parole decisions, so deciding if you should grant parole or not to individuals. And there are some issues with fairness that are being researched now in terms of how fair or, say, biased are these decision-making algorithms. And that's one major thing to think about. And a second related thing to think about is, let's say we don't grant parole to a certain class of individuals. Like our algorithm just says, never grant them parole. Well, we're also, if we want to collect data in the future, we're never getting data on that category of individuals, and so we never learn that our system maybe was wrong. And so, again, if the machine learning algorithm is influencing the data that then's going to train the next iteration of the machine learning algorithm, you really need to be careful. So another thing to think about is that oftentimes problems aren't even AI problems at all. So there are lots of problems that involve humans getting together to make decisions as collectives, for example, political problems, or to deal with emotional or relationship issues like social problems. And in many cases, just computers aren't there to solve these problems for us. These are human-human problems that involve conflict resolution and other very important discussions that we just can't program a computer to tell us the right solution. Another example, though, is that there are learning problems that aren't machine learning problems. So as mentioned, machine learning is generating new predictions from data, but a lot of problems don't require data, they require insight. And so in the middle here, for example, is there's a text that was looks like gibberish, but in fact it was generated according to something that's called a Caesar cipher. And so what a Caesar cipher is that for each letter in the alphabet, we replace it with a different letter in the alphabet. So for example, A becomes F and B becomes Q, etc. And so if you have insight, what you can realize is that in English text, the letter E occurs the most often. So maybe we can count up the letter that occurs most often and make that an E. And then by doing this procedure, you can translate that back into its original text. But we see here, right, that this required two levels of insight. It required that we understand that this text isn't gibberish. Maybe it does represent something real. And the second thing was how to go about this translation process. It didn't require lots of data. It required insight to see that that's there. Another example of this is the code talkers during World War II, where instead of taking English, encrypting it, and sending it over the radio, instead they had native Navajo speakers speaking over the radio. So if you're German and have never heard Navajo before, this sounds like gibberish, and maybe you think that this text is somehow encrypted. Well, instead it's a different language entirely. And if you had the insight to realize that it's Navajo, maybe you could do something about it. But in Germany, there weren't very many native Navajo speakers, and so they never noticed this. So to summarize, machine learning is good and has made lots of major advances on problems that previously had been hard. However, there are these really important caveats to consider. And so our advice to you is to have clean data and clear questions before you start to think about algorithms. Make sure you have what you need to answer the question before you think about ways of how to answer the question. And also then, before you deploy this system, we encourage you to think about all of these caveats that we've mentioned. For example, transparency and different kinds of feedbacks that the system might have with itself.